Hey everybody, this is an Engraving Matter coming to you for your wonderful YouTube viewing. I just wanted to say thank you so much. I never expected my 6mm poplar cut video to reach the levels that it's reached. I want to say thank you. Right now it's sitting at 130,000 views. For all of the views, thank you guys so much. I greatly appreciate it. There have been a lot of questions on that one video. A lot of people have made contact with me and basically picked my brain for a while. And that's fine, and that's I don't mind doing that. I think it's a great thing to do to help those in the laser community with what knowledge I do have. Well, one of the things I do have is a great understanding of LaserDRW 3. Now, one of the things I want you guys to know is LaserDRW 3 is a proprietary software directly from China, from the company that makes the original K40, the blue and white. It doesn't have an electronic amp meter. It just has the tube. It comes with a cheap water pump, which, surprisingly enough, is still working almost a year later. And it also has a bunch of other stuff with it. The fan finally burned out, so I went ahead and I got an inline fan. Let me go ahead and I'll show you that real quick. I went ahead and I took my ducting. At the end of my ducting, I stuck in an inline fan. Let me go ahead and zoom in on that for you. Wait for my camera to focus. I do apologize. I'm using my Canon i6, Rebel i6 for this, so it takes a second to focus. So now, I've been asked to do a couple videos when it comes to the wonderful world of LaserDRW 3. Pardon me, I accidentally got a little something on the lens. So what we're going to go over, I'm going to readjust the camera angle and I'm going to show you start to finish how I would do a simple project. Basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a anodized dog tag. Let me grab one for you. These are the anodized dog tags I use. I get them from Chewbarker.com. Really great company. Some of the best quality I've ever seen. One thing I want you to see is if you look on that edge is perfectly blue all the way around. There is no silver showing. These aren't anodized and then stamped out. These are stamped out and then hand anodized by the company. The other cool thing about these dog tags is when you actually use them in your laser, you don't get that shiny silver color or that dull silver color underneath the anodization. When you engrave on them, you actually get a white color, because when they hand dip and hand anodize these dog tags, you end up getting a wonderful, wonderful white to whatever color it is contrast. I've used every color they have, from gold to blue to silver, the standard aluminum color. It comes out white underneath and it's great. It comes out really well. But I'm going to show you how I do a project from one end to the other. I'm just going to use the dog tags. As you can tell, there's not much engraving space, so it won't take too long to fill it. And then we can go from there. And I'll put this video up on YouTube, which is why you're watching it right now. And if you have any more questions about the basic aspects of LaserDRW, then I can go into those other questions. But let's go ahead and get started, shall we? I'm gonna go ahead, step out of the way, move my camera over to my computer. I gotta readjust everything because I was actually using my camera's flip around lens. So, first thing we're going to do, get my little mouse over here so I can actually use it from behind the camera. First thing we're going to do is we're going to open the program. I actually have a copy of it set down here on the bottom. I know it's kind of hard to see my mouse, but well, it's harder for me because I'm looking on a little screen as well as looking at my laptop. So I'm going to go ahead. There's three programs I really use when it comes to my laser engraving. I use Google Chrome to source my photos. Now note, I don't source stuff that is copyrighted. If you want a quick way to go out of business by being sent a cease and desist order and then disobeying that cease and desist order, by all means, go ahead and do not go ahead and do bad things with copyrighted material. Now, I will tell you, I do make personal stuff for family, but I do not profit from it. Sometimes I'll make, you know, mirrors and whatnot, but since I don't use the whole logo, the copyright infringement doesn't apply, just like small towns have used the main logo for Green Bay. That main logo for Green Bay has been used by the Gators. It's been used by other local schools and other schools across the country. And whether or not they've gotten permission, they've never used the whole logo, so therefore they're able to use it. So that's why I don't use the full logos. I do make custom stuff for family and friends. I don't charge those, so therefore I do not infringe copyrights. First thing I do, we're going to go ahead and open up. It says Windseal, but it's actually LaserDRW, as you can tell by the upper left-hand corner of that little window that just popped up. Okay, now it just brought up the last program, project I was working on. Whenever you start a new project, there you got this little icon right here, which is New Layout, or you can go to File, and then go to New Layout. Either one will work. Either one works just fine. I like the quick link buttons. When you bring it up, you're going to see this little window here called New Layout Window. This is where you measure your piece of work. Now, the reason why I say to measure it, and if I were you, I would get a tape measure that has millimeters on it, or at the least centimeters with the minimal marks in between the centimeters. That way you can actually measure in millimeters and get your numbers correct so you're as precise as possible. Now, I have an old school, my camera's probably not going to focus on this, so I apologize. There it goes. I have an old school measurement. It goes 3.6 meters and also 12 feet. Automatic return. That was a big thing back in the day when it first started. Now it's standard. But this does measure in millimeters or centimeters. If you'll notice on the right side, it does inches. On the left side, it does centimeters. Each individual mark between the big numbers is a millimeter. So 2 centimeters is 20 millimeters, so on and so forth. So, when I measured a dog tag, it is 50 millimeters or 5 centimeters from tip to tip, and it's 29 millimeters wide or 2.9 centimeters. So I put those in. You want the rectangle shape. Now, if you notice over here, see how it says margin? That margin right there will give you a basically like a safety zone. Like, let's say you're using a wood plaque here. I'll show you this, for instance. You can get these little wood plaques at Walmart, and you get them in oval, you can get them in circle. But if you notice, it's got that decorative beveled edge. You can measure how thick that edge is, and you can set that to be your margin. What that does is it shrinks your work area down by that much, so you have a set work area so you don't accidentally go over your margins and go into the bevel. So all that information right there is correct, because if you don't use the margin, the laser workspace should be the same as drawing workspace. So we're going to go and hit OK on that. It's going to give me a brand new rectangle, and it's going to put this thick border on the edge. I hate this border. First thing I do is I delete it. Okay, so now what am I going to put on there? Let's go ahead, and we're just going to put on some text. That's going to be this. If you'll notice, there's this line right here. The one to the left of it is bitmap. That's how you load pictures into LaserDRW. Right now, we're just going to do straight text, so we're going to go right here to line text. And we're going to say, hi, YouTube. Now, from here, you can select all sorts of fonts. You can select the character size. Since this is only 50 millimeters tall, I don't want to make my character size more than 50 millimeters because it will go beyond the region of the actual dog tag. So we're just going to leave it at 4 millimeters, and then I'll show you why. But we're going to go ahead and we're just going to select, I'll go to one of my favorites, which is right here, I forget what it's called. But if you arrow up and down through these, you'll see the text change live. Okay. That one video I did with the love Everyone was asking me what the pattern was. It wasn't a pattern, it's a font. It's called Respective Slanted, which is that one right there. Or you've got Standards, you've got Opera, you've got Script, you've got New Goth, Mirman, MS Serif, MS Sans Serif. So we're going to go ahead and use Respective Slanted. They also have Respected Swashes, but it doesn't work with capitals. You have to put everything in lowercase for it to translate it. So we're going to go ahead and do Respective Slanted. We're going to go over here, we're going to hit OK. Now notice, before I hit OK, Outline is unchecked, Italic is unchecked, but Bold is checked. When you're doing small prints on certain fonts, you want to have it bolded. And LaserDRW will automatically default to the bold setting. So if you don't want bold, you have to uncheck that. And that will change the look once you get on there, and I'll show you that. So now, I'm going to find a corner, and I'm going to go across. And you want to try and get a straight line. If you can't get a straight line using your mouse, which right now it's going to be a little hard for me, because I'm trying to do this 3 feet away from the computer. Okay, so now I've got that on there. If you notice, it looks a little funky. It's kind of squished down. It's really wide, but really short. Doesn't look right. So what we're going to do, instead of, I can do one of two things. I can adjust it manually by grabbing this blue square at the top and moving it up to where it looks right. Or I can go over here on the right-hand side to character height. Let me get a nice zoom in of that. See where it says C-H-A-R with a capital H? That's character height. You can adjust the character height. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to make it an even 20 millimeters. Okay. So now, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to click back over here on the font. Now see this little purple square here, dead center of all the text? If you double click on that, it centers it on your workspace. Cool thing about that is if you want to have something perfectly centered, use the main graph lines. You'll see this dark red graph line here that goes horizontal and this dark red graph line here that goes vertical. If you're measuring your piece accurately, you will get an item perfectly centered on your piece if you do it this way. Now, I will preface that by saying that some fonts are not equal. Because Respective Slanted carries in all these swooshes and all these big loops and everything, technically it is equal from the bottom of this H to the top of the H. It is 100% equal. Now if you look at the top of the I, that doesn't look equal because the top of the I is actually counted from the top of the dot on the I. Okay? Just to give you a little heads up of what you're looking at. So what we're going to do, we've already got this centered, we've got it on there. Now the one thing I did want to show you is, watch how this changes. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to click the bold checkbox on the right. Let me slide over so you can see that. Over here where you select everything. Everything I had in that little window, I can select it here with more options. I can adjust the sizes. I can make the X2 parameter, I can shrink it to the left or to the right. X1 parameter, I can shrink it to the right or grow it to the left. Same thing with the Y parameters. And it also tells you what your center parameter is, which since this thing is 50 millimeters tall, the true center should be 25 millimeters. Right now it's 25.013. 1/100th of a millimeter is not that big. Don't worry anything past that 0.1 or 0.0. Anything beyond that is going to be extremely minimal and you're not going to notice it unless you're really dealing with very precise numbers. You're doing something that has to be, you know, 22.43 millimeters tall. If you have something that precise, don't try it with the K40 because you're never going to reach that goal. Trust me, I have tried. The only way to reach that goal is if you upgrade the laser and upgrade all the parts within it. So, that being said, now I'm going to go ahead and show you a couple other things. Now, as we go across our wonderful menu here at the top, I want you guys to see this. Like I said, I am moving stuff around as I do all this. Okay, so we're going to go from left to right across the menu bar. You have New Layout, you have Open, you have Save, You have send to print layout. You also have print. Then you have back or undo. You have redo or forward. Cut, paste. I'm sorry, cut, copy, and then paste. Delete. Ungroup text. Now, if I hit the ungroup text right now, I could actually make the H bigger, smaller as a capital than the I, the O bigger than the Y, and so on and so forth. It allows you to adjust the characters, even though they're all the same font, you can actually adjust their size without screwing up whether what's capital, what's lowercase, and all that. Then you also have this bad boy right here, which is display grid. If I click that, my grid goes away. I do not ever take the grid off just because I like to have it just in case. Then you've got the zoom in and zoom out. If you're trying to get really precise or you want to see how you have something layered, zoom in. You can zoom in pretty big. If you notice the little square you see right there, that's 1 millimeter square. So from here to here, that's 1 millimeter. From here to here, that's 1 millimeter. And that's how big that wonderful part of that Y is. It'll almost fill that one Y. Now, if I need to zoom back out, I can hit the zoom out button. Or if I want to hit normal, I just hit normal. That shows you exactly how big of a piece you can actually look at on here without having to zoom in or zoom out. It does not necessarily mean how big of a piece you can do on your laser. Please don't take that as what I'm saying. Now, if you noticed in the upper left-hand corner, as I zoomed in or zoomed out, you see that dark blue? See how it grows? Because that's telling you what is within and what is not within your work area, which you already told that you were working with. Little helpers to tell you what you do and don't have. And then we've got the maximize, which puts the one piece that you're working on, that size, that work area, it fills the window with it so you can actually use it to the fullest extent. You can see my dark red border is all the way around, okay? Now, if I had this set up in portrait mode for that one dog tag, you'd be able to see that as well, and it wouldn't show nearly as big. It kind of trips me out. That's why I like to do everything in landscape mode. It helps me be more accurate. And yes, with landscape mode, I want to show you this real quick, and then I'm going to undo it. If I come down here to this wonderful little green dot, not only does that allow me to do to adjust the X 0.2x, as it's called, I can make the 0.2x go up, or I can make it go down, or I can angle it, or I can actually reverse it, which just flips it upside down. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to hit undo to get it back to where it was. Okay, so now we're going to start off here with the arrow. You've got the point mode. Select. You've got the dot, which is a square dot. You've got a line. You've got an ellipse, which is what this program calls a circle. Then you have a triangle. You have a rectangle. You have a diamond, and it calls it, I couldn't catch it as it came up because I never paid attention to it, a losangle or losang. And then you've got five star, or AKA a star. Then you've got your bitmap load. If you want to load a bitmap, click on that. It goes to whatever folder you want to load something from. And like I said, guys, you're going to see a bunch of stuff on here that is copyright material. But I used it on test cases. I used it on personal stuff. I have not made a profit for anything you're seeing that has it. Like some of these pictures you're seeing here. I'm grabbing a test piece to show you. If you see this bad boy, nope, not that one right there. It's somewhere else. Anyway, two-tone draw picture. I mean, a deer picture. Half fits engraved, half fits not. Came out really well. It looks better in person than it does on the camera. If I change the angle of it, maybe that'll help because the light. One of my lights in my shop went out and I still haven't replaced it yet. I'm still waiting on bulbs to come in the mail. So, you know, just for the heck of it, we're going to grab a little Eeyore. We're going to hit open. And we're going to stick Eeyore up here, just above tube. And then we're going to take YouTube and we're going to move it down using the arrow. That way we keep it centered on the top and on the left and right. And then we're going to take Eeyore. We're going to use the purple dot on him and center him. And then we're going to use the arrow on the computer. We're going to move him up. That way he's centered from left to right. But I move him up and down. And then we get Eeyore. Now, after the bitmap, you've got the identifier. You've got line text. You've got line Mongolian text. You've got line Arabic text. You've got accurated text. Oh, I'm sorry, arcuated text and arcuated Mongolian, arcuated Mongolian text and arcuated Arabic text. You really only need this one right here, which is the line text, and then the arcuated text, which basically allows you to put it in a circle. Pretty cool feature. You got to mess with it a little bit to be finessed with it and be able to make everything look good. But once you get good at it, your stuff will come out nice. Okay, so now we're almost to the main part of the actual engraving. So now I've got my pattern set. Now I'm going to go over the top 7 icons at the top. Okay, sorry, 8 icons. My mouse is covering one. So the first icon is the engrave window. It has a shortcut key of the space bar. If you don't have anything selected, like Eeyore here, if I unselect Eeyore and I hit the space bar, my engrave screen is going to come up, and as you can hear in the background, my laser moved. Because the minute you go to the engrave screen, the laser will go to your home point wherever you have it set. This triangle right here is tasks waiting or pause. Since I don't have it running, I don't need to pause it. This one right here is release rail. If I click that, I can manually move my laser head. The what looks like a previous chapter button is the reset button. If you hit that, I'm sure you heard that on the video, it resets the laser back to the home point. So if I release the rail and move the laser head to the bottom right hand corner of this machine and I hit the reset, it'll reset. This right here is the stop button. If you need to stop an operation, whether it's an emergency, if you have to stop something in an emergency, just hit the power button on the machine. If you need to stop it because, oh shoot, you put it in mirror mode, or you have it misaligned, or your piece vibrated somewhere, or whatever the case may be, if something went wrong and you need to stop engraving and it's not an emergency, use that button right there. And then this right here is the clear laser tasks. That right there will allow you to clear any laser tasks that you may have stored on the machine. All right, now when it comes to clearing laser tasks, the one thing you got to remember is if you use that previous button I was telling you about on the stop, if you actually use that to stop it, it's going to show the remainder of that task of putting on the laser engraver. It's going to actually put that as a laser task on standby, and you actually clear it out using that. The reason why I say to always double check that is if you don't and you go to engrave a new project and you haven't cleared out your laser tasks, it's going to start with the first task in the queue, and that will result in you engraving something you probably didn't want to engrave, or that you've already moved beyond, or you fixed the error and now you want to move forward. So it's basically just a common aspect. Now these next two buttons I don't use. This one is manufacturer's information. Whoopee! You get to know it's from China. And this one is about laser draw. It tells you it was made by some guy from China. Okay, so yeah, basically the majority of the software is redundant. When it comes to trying to learn about the actual maker of the software. I'm going to flip the camera around real quick so we're getting ready to move to the actual machine. I got to zoom out so you can actually see my wonderful face here. Okay, so a few things you want to remember about LaserDRW. It's proprietary. It was made by the people that made the machine. They made it for simplistic use. However simplistic it is, if you use your mind to think about how you can say, okay, I want to do this, this, and this, how can I accomplish that task? When it comes to laser draw, you can accomplish it very easily. Let's say you wanted to create a clock of Mickey Mouse's head. Yes, I know we're going into proprietary crap again. I don't care. This is a fictional situation. Okay. But you wanted to engrave Mickey's face on that head before you cut it out. Here's how I did something similar using a drawing someone did for me. Basically what you do is you take that whole, let's say it's Mickey Mouse's head, okay? Everyone knows the triple pancake shape. You got the big two ears and then the big circle in the middle, okay? Well, let's say someone's found a picture of that face, okay? You take that face, you take that same picture, okay? You make a copy of it. You black it out. In laser draw, it will only engrave where it's black, or it'll cut around the outside edge of black. So for instance, like on what we're looking at right here on the computer, when it comes to Hi YouTube and Eeyore, if I told it to cut that out, the dot would fall out, the H, U, the Hi and YouTube would be connected right here at the bottom, and all the little pieces in between Eeyore's lines would be cut out. Now, that being said, I've made cake toppers out of 3mm acrylic. And that's a really cool thing to do. Because what you're doing is you're actually creating a form, you know, like an upside down field goal post with a name and a decorative form. Go on Etsy and you'll understand what I'm talking about. If you realize how to do it, it actually is really cool. It's just as cool as these 3D engraved LED lamps that everybody's going all crazy about now and looking for the LED bases. Don't ask me, I don't know. I don't want to be in that market. I've got other things in mind for stuff I want to do. I'm really big on the wood engraving and the wood cutting. I'm really big on dog tags. I'm really big on reaching out to local Christian artists here in Colorado and across the country. If you're a Christian artist and you want custom engraved dog tags, get in contact with me. Whatever price you're getting from somebody, I can beat it, and that's with more than one paint color. I don't believe I have the example I usually use with me, but one of the examples I have, I use two examples just to show how I can do multiple paint colors. There's a wrestler out in Salina, Kansas for a group called XWE. His name is Blade. I actually took a dog tag that was black, put painter tape over it, engraved it, spray painted in the paint color I wanted, waited for it to dry, took off the painter's tape, clear coated it, and now he's got a two color tone dog tag out of a dog tag that we usually engrave the color and white. Simple process. I could probably do it three ways if you needed me to. So anybody out there watching, if you have any friends or family in the music business and they're looking for merchandise, please send them my way. I don't get paid for these videos. I try not to subscribe to YouTube's advertising methods on my videos. I make them to help. If you buy something from me, great. If you use my knowledge and you create a business out of it, great. That's all what this country's about. Taking something and running with it. None of the materials or anything I've discussed in this whole thing, besides the program itself and the particular pictures or very well-known items that I've talked about, are copyrighted, so therefore you shouldn't have any issues. So there are a couple things I want to show you inside the engraving screen before we actually get to the wonderful laser. So I'm going to flip the camera around again and we're going to go over the engraving screen itself. There are a lot of details in this next section of the video. Please pay close attention because I guarantee, and I really seriously mean that, I guarantee the information I'm about to present to you will resolve 100 different problems that you'll come across just because of the fact that, oh crap, really? I didn't know that. It's really cool. One thing I want to show you before we get to there is I want to show you the inside my machine. I've created this wonderful, what I call, let me make my camera focus here. This right here is my zero point, okay? I made this in the aluminum shop at my last employer I was at. It's pure aluminum, made of parts of a door and some solid aluminum. It is perfectly square. I have it resting up against the vent. And I have another piece of aluminum set against it. So if I have a small piece, like this right here, I can actually move it down here to the middle. Come on, camera, focus for me. I can actually move it down here to the middle, and I can move this thing with it, so I've got that square edge. So that's what I'm saying is let's say this was bigger. For instance, like that wonderful, if I put in a big piece of glass or something, I don't want it to be pressurized in this corner. I want it to be even halfway down the glass. So I'm going to make sure that I have something I can move with it, and I have another one to use on my y-axis. Okay. Now the reason why I have this board in here while doing dog tags, that right there gets my dog tag exactly at the 2-inch mark, or 50.2 millimeters, which is the size focal lens I have inside the head of the laser itself. So now we're going to flip around and go back to the computer. I've got to flip my screen around so I can see what I'm doing. So I'm going to zoom in really good, make sure my camera focuses. And I want you to pay close attention to this next part, guys, because this next part is really important. So first thing I want you to notice, if you look here in the big window right here, this is your work bed area. No, it is not accurate to the size of your machine. Most of the things in LaserDRW are not that accurate when it comes to general aspects. When it comes to the definitive aspects, yes, it's very accurate. Okay, so now, here is what I'm engraving. It's 50.035 by 29.0322. Now, up here, you have your selector. You select engraving, you can select cutting, or you can select marking. If you're going to do marking, make sure it's on a slow setting. Anything over 22 millimeters a second on marking, your machine will go haywire. Why? I don't know. I haven't been able to figure it out. Cutting, same thing. Don't go over 22 millimeters a second speed-wise. Engraving, do not go over 400 millimeters a second. If you're able to do so because you figured out the problem, please come back to me and tell me what you did, because that one thing has been bugging the heck out of me. So I'm going to keep it on engraving, because all we're doing is engraving a dog tag. I set it at 350 millimeters a second. Now, underneath common parameters, all these should be zeros or the defaults. Now, if you wanted it to refer to the top bottom right as to where it is, it works. It's accurate on referring to the bottom right of wherever it is. However, it won't start engraving in the bottom right. It'll start engraving in the top left, no matter what. You can't do like they do in the epilogue video and tell it to engrave bottom to top. It's always going to engrave left to right, top to bottom. Period. That's just how this machine was made and the programming was written. You'll never find anything otherwise. Now, down here underneath advanced parameters, method, all layers, pixel, 1, repeat, 1. Power, 75, that doesn't apply. Then you go down here to bounds line, no. Okay, now, see this right here where it says laser head step by? You can manually control that just like you do with up down arrows. Now, something I was going to show you, which I can't remember at this time just because I'm losing my mind. Oh, that's right. You've got rotate. You can do nothing. Mirror it, which if I mirror it, you'll see it change in the upper left-hand corner. I'll do it again. Okay. Anytime you mirror it, it'll actually engrave in the mirrored form. Don't mirror it unless you mean to. Now, let's say you were going to do that wonderful thing I was telling you about where you engrave and then cut out. This does not have the ability to do the multiple lines on one thing until it's a go and it does the engraving before the cut. However, you can do that manually. How, you ask, and have it done in one press of a button? You technically can't, but here's a trick to make it look like it, okay? And yes, I know there's always tricks. I think you'll like this one. If you see down here, remember that word I told you about? There was a button to clear the tasks. Well, here's a button to add them. If I was to add an engraving task right now, it would add the task to engrave everything that I showed you on that main screen. Okay? But it wouldn't start the engraving process until I open the engraving window back up and hit starting. So, for example, I'm going to hit cancel. I'm going to go here and I'm going to delete Eeyore. Okay? So now I'm going to go back into engraving. I'm going to go down here to add task. If I hit add task, it's only going to engrave what's on the screen at the time. So now I'm going to hit the undo button, bring Eeyore back, and I'm going to make the Hi YouTube disappear. Then I'm going to go back here, and if I hit add task, it'll just engrave Eeyore in that task. But right now, that's going to be the second task in the process. If I hit starting, it'll start by engraving the Hi YouTube, and then it'll come back to the second task and engrave Eeyore. Now, I'm not going to do either one. I'm going to hit cancel, so I want to engrave them all at the same time. That was just just to show you. But notice, up here where I had my remove all tasks icon, notice that that X is now red. That means you've got a task in your foray. So if I was to hit engraving and then starting, that first task, which is just the Hi YouTube, would be the first thing it would engrave. And we don't want that, so we're going to clear the tasks. It's going to ask us, are we sure, blah blah blah, yes. Okay, now there is one other side I want to show you to the engraving screen, and then we'll get to the engraving itself. When you go into the engraving screen, you've got this wonderful window here called button here called Properties. Click on Properties. Now, underneath here is where creating my own zero-point fixture actually benefited me, because I was able to make the machine work with it. The reason how I did that is right here, where it says origin X and Y. If your machine is not starting in the same place every time, I have no clue what your problem is. But if it's not starting in the upper left-hand corner where you want it, and in the engrave screen, which is right here behind, right here, where my mouse is, if your stuff's in the upper left-hand corner and your laser's not starting there, come here to your origin screen. Put a piece of wood or something in your bed, align your laser where you want the zero point to be, use the test laser button to make sure it's there, and you set it here. Notice I have it X at 2 millimeters and Y at 14.75. If I didn't have that vent sticking out so dang much, if I cut it off by 15 millimeters, I would have almost a true 0-0 point, and I'd actually be able to engrave almost a 12 by 12 square. And you're looking at me thinking, wait a minute, they said it was only 200 by 300 millimeters, so how in the world can I get to 12 inches by 12 inches? Easy. And I'll show you that when we get to the machine. A couple things I've done, they have helped, and they've actually made it more efficient. One of my biggest products right now that I do is I engrave an 8x10 mirror, which fits perfectly into an 8x10 frame. So doing that, people get really nice mirrors that they can hang on their wall in a standard frame, and I get money to help support me and my 4 kids. So, that being said, this is where you would go to do it. Now, if you'll notice, I made the page size 400 by 400. I'll never have anything that big, so that's why I made it that big, so it stays out of my way. Max speed is 500. Don't worry about that. You'll never reach it. And if you do, please let me know how. Resolution, leave that at 1,000. Do not change that. If you change that, you will shoot yourself in the foot, because it will change how everything comes out. Now, right here where it says main board, that number that's on there, or that board that's on there, that's what's inside your machine. See right here where it says device ID? That's the number you need to pull off of your board inside your laser, and I'll show you where that is in about 30 seconds here once I get the laser set up to engrave this little dog tag. You'll need to use that to be able to activate your laser so it will work with laser draw. If you do not do that, your laser will not work with laser draw, and you will basically have a giant blue and white brick. Not as strong as a brick, nowhere near as useful, because usually a brick you can pick up and throw at somebody you don't like. If you can do that with this machine, you don't need to be doing laser engraving. You should be doing something else like bodybuilding. So, on the right-hand side, you've got the running in adjustment, which is the X-rail and the Y-rail. I left those where they were. Repeat 1000, I left that where it was. Those are defaults. I left them there. Control for adjustment, speed, 400 millimeters. I haven't messed with that. I didn't want to mess with too many settings when I first got this video. So because of that, I went ahead and I left it at default. So now I'm going to hit apply. Even though we didn't change anything, I'm going to hit OK. Now it goes back to this screen. So now we're where I want to be so I can start the engraving. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to move the camera over and show you how I set up the machine. And we'll go from there. So one second. All right, get the wide angle here. So first thing I want to show you, I'm probably going to have to move the camera a little on this one. You can see my wonderful amp meter there. Now, if my camera will stay focused, you can also see my test switch, okay? So these numbers right here are on the dial. They are not accurate by any means. Do not pay them any mind. Use your milliamp meter, okay? So I have a piece of wood underneath my laser right now, so I'm just going to press it, and you're going to see where it stops. It should stop on 10, because that's where I left it last time I used it. Okay, so I'm sitting at 11, so I'm going to decrease it just a little. So now my laser is perfectly set on 10 milliamps. That's 33% of the usage of this laser. It's supposedly a 40 watt, it's not, it's a 30 watt. You can tell that by the length. If you want to know all the length information, go Google it. I don't have it memorized. So, give me about 2 seconds here. I'm going to get refocused, and then we're going to start with setup. All right, guys, here we are. We are set to do our engraving. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to grab a dog tag. Now, remember earlier when I was telling you about the dog tags I use from Chewbacca are high quality and they're not cheap pieces of crap? Well, I'll show you the difference, okay? And I want you to see this. This right here is a solid blue dog tag. Nice, deep blue color, really good color, okay? Now here is a dog tag I got off of eBay. They were extremely inexpensive. Look what happens when I turn to the side. See that silver stripe? Let's go back to the Chewbacca dog tag. See that blue dog tag? Hey, look at that. It's blue on the side as well. Now, let's look at them side by side. Look at the thickness difference. Let me see if I can get the camera to focus. See that thickness difference? I mean, that is a huge difference. The Chewbacca dog tag is almost twice as thick. Plus, it has a solid colored edge instead of that silver, which means this red one was first colored on a giant sheet and then punched out, and no one desired to color this silver edge. So, yeah, after I realized how good quality Chewbacca was, I went to them and I've never gone back. So, first thing I want to do, I want to get my dog tag here in the upper left-hand corner. I want it up to the ridge as much as possible. Now, I have little blocks here that I like to use. They just keep my material from sliding around. I just rest it against it. I don't put a clamp on it or nothing. I've seen people use magnets. That's an ingenious idea. I actually really like it. With a dog tag, I don't really need it, especially when I have it on a piece of wood, but I just wanted to show you that. So now, the other thing I was telling you about earlier, when it comes to setting up your machine and you have that code, if you remove the screw that's usually right here and you lift this up, you come in, you look right there on the board. That one green board has a sticker on it. I don't know if you can see that white sticker right there, but that white sticker has that code that is currently on LaserDRW. There we go. You can see the code now. That right there is the code you need to look for. Okay. Pardon me. Now, what that code does, that code tells LaserDRW all the parameters that your laser is capable of, and it also tells the wonderful machine how to operate it. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to shut this back down. Now you've got my on switch, you got my laser switch, you got my test switch, current regulation, which is how much electricity is flowing through it, and the current indication, which is the amp meter. And you can tell this is from China, especially if you look at the attention marker. I mean, some of this stuff is so stupid. Make sure to run the water pump before you switch on the laser. Duh. Always connect the ground connector to a grounded outlet. Well, guess what? Duh. So, anyway, sorry. I'm going off on tangents. Now, I was actually looking for my tape measure real quick. Just to show you. Since I don't have an adjustable bed, I have to make the adjustments myself. I know that that lens sits approximately 2 millimeters up from the edge, which, since that marker on the 2 right there is just a tad bit above, past the edge of the laser head, I know that that dog tag is sitting perfectly at 2 inches or 50.2 millimeters. Now, I'm going to go ahead and put on my laser safety goggles so I can leave this lid open. I will tell you, be careful if you're going to leave your laser lid open. This does not have a safety switch, so if you do leave your lid open, the machine's not going to say, "Oh my God, shut the lid! Shut the front door!" No, it's going to keep going. And if you accidentally hit a reflective surface on, like, my aluminum zero point feature, which I have in there, you will be blinded. Do not leave it open at home unless you have proper laser safety goggles. I don't want to see you guys blinded or get someone calling me, "Well, you did it. I thought I could do it." No, you don't think you can do it. Because guess what? I told you not to. And if you don't like that, then you probably shouldn't be watching my videos, and you probably shouldn't own a laser, to be 100% honest with you. So I'm just going to do some final adjustments on my camera real quick, get you a nice angle of the engraving. There we go, nice downward angle, perfectly centered in the screen. Got my mouse right here. I'm going to go ahead and hit start. And this is going to start off at the top with Eeyore's head, moving left to right, going top to bottom. And good thing with the anodized dog tags is there is no smoke. There's no, basically there's nothing that's going to come out of this except for a dog tag. There's no other remnants that come out of it because of how the laser vaporizes everything it hits on these dog tags, which is another reason why I love them. If you need good quality dog tag blanks or other stuff, like they've got license plates, they've got wristbands, they've got thousands of different things. So if you need good quality stock to start your business off with, go to Chewbarker.com, let them know that an engraving matter sent you, just to let them know they're being bragged on. I don't receive any kickbacks, I don't receive any free merchandise from them, I endorse them because they make good quality stuff, fast shipping, great customer service. I probably will never use anybody else unless they can beat the price, which when you buy in the quantities that I buy, probably not going to happen. So here we go. I'm going to hit the starting button. Laser activates, and there we go. Top of Eeyore's head is starting to engrave. And unfortunately, because this is an extremely small picture on this really small dog tag, Eeyore's probably not going to look that good. I'll warn you about that right now. But the hot YouTube part, that part should actually come out really well, to be honest. Yeah, I probably should have used a different photo or something. But I think you'll like the high YouTube part. This is going to come out looking really nice on the high YouTube part. Eeyore, not so much. Now, if I had done a dog tag with Eeyore by himself, yeah, it probably would have come out looking a lot better. But you know what, just for the heck of it, while that one's engraving, I'll go ahead and I'll set up Eeyore to be engraved fully on the other side. Just to give you guys something to look at when it comes to pictures. What you didn't see me do, I already have it done. As you get to hear me, I told you I was going to just do that. As you can tell, the camera didn't get shut off once while it was engraving. So you know that it was just that quick. Once you're really good at laser draw, you can do some amazing stuff, guys. And I'm talking seriously amazing. I have surprised myself. I mean, I'll go to do a project and think, oh, how can I accomplish that? And then I end up accomplishing it, and it kind of blows myself away because I didn't think I ever would. And we should be nearing it. Now, if you notice, it's going off the edge of part of the dog tag onto the wood. I expected that. This is just an example. I wasn't putting too much time into how it was actually going to come out. Okay. So now, dog tag is done. It's cool to the touch. Like I said, poor little Eeyore did not fare too well. I mean, not too bad, considering that he's, you know, barely 6 millimeters tall. Well, I'd say he's maybe a centimeter tall. But if you notice, that solid sheen is there, except for a little bit here and there. And notice how it's nice and white, and you get that nice clean contrast on those dog tags. That is why I choose ChewBarker.com. So now I'm going to flip it over. As you can tell, it's completely blank on the other side. No magic tricks, nothing up my sleeve. And we're going to stick it back in the machine. Hit the engrave button. Hit starting, and you're going to see Eeyore start to appear on this wonderful dog tag with pristine accuracy. Now, I know this video is going a little long, so I do apologize, but I wanted to show you guys all the features I've gotten to know when it comes to this laser. And all the cool features that I happen to really like about this laser. Just so you know, if this video cuts out, my battery's running a little low. Hopefully it'll make it to the end of the process. So, if not, I'll put a picture at the end of the video showing what the final product looks like. As you can tell, Eeyore, when he's almost 50 millimeters tall, is a lot different from when he's only 10 millimeters tall. finishing the tail. And like I said, I didn't set the parameters 100% correct. However, there's Eeyore. Thank you for watching.